Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Vanished, True Stories from Families of Australian Missing Persons, written and read by Nicole Morris. Foreword by Mark and Faye Leveson. Nicole will embrace and engender the interest of the reader by her clever use imagery, where she allows one to feel as though they are there with the victims and their families through this nightmare ride. She helps you to feel a range of emotions felt by people closely affected by ambiguous loss and crime. When our son Matthew was taken from us in 2007, we put our faith in authorities, thinking they were acting in our best interests. Sadly, this is not always the case. The public need to understand that the authorities are not perfect, that the investigators are not always right, that victims and their families become second-class citizens in the so-called justice system. On reading these carefully crafted chapters, you can feel the emotion, feel the hope, feel the devastation of having that hope destroyed, and understand that quite often two people provided with the exact same set of circumstances can form totally different views. So often, victims of crime and people who have suffered ambiguous loss can lose friends. People just don't know what to say to you, so they will hide or step away. This doesn't help victims or their families. The reader will come to understand this upon reading these pages. Victims and those left behind, in order not to feel useless, will quite readily immerse themselves directly into an investigation, not the police's, but their own. Quite often, we had police asking us for intel, as ours was more comprehensive and current than their own. You will come to understand why the individuals you will read about did just that. In many cases, the authorities merely work on these cases. However, the families have lived in these cases. You will discover the distinct difference. We commend Nicole for creating this wonderful record and the fact that it also keeps alive the memory of those who may no longer be with us and are unable to speak for themselves. Introduction. My friend died. There's no easy way of saying that, is there? You can't just sort of slip it into a conversation. What an awful thing to have to tell people. Greg died suddenly from a heart attack in 2009. He was the same age as me, so it was a terrible shock. We had been friends since we were 4 or 5. We were in kindergarten together, a 35-year friendship. His sister rang me to tell me. I hadn't talked to her in about 20 years, so I didn't understand why she was ringing me, although I'd always remembered her as Greg's sweet little sister. Poor Kathleen, to have to make that call, not just to me, but to all Greg's friends. People she didn't know very well, people she hadn't seen in a long time, people she may not have known at all, saying the same thing over and over, "My brother has died," reminding herself of the awful fact every time she had to repeat it. Calling people and explaining who she was, that she was Greg's sister and they may not know her, but she had something to tell them. Keeping her tone calm, trying not to break down while feeling like her world has collapsed around her. But you can't break down. You have important news to tell this person. You have to stay strong. She was amazingly strong on the phone to me, probably from saying her heartbreaking rehearsed speech so many times. It wasn't until I said, "Kathleen, it is so terrible for me to hear this, but this is so horrifically awful for you to have to make these phone calls and tell people." And it was then that I heard the falter, the break in her voice as she said, "Yes, it is." And that is why I wrote this book. I started Australian Missing Persons Register in 2005 after realising that there needed to be an internet resource to help find the missing, and I decided to create one. Over the many years since then, I have come to know the families of the missing very well. They have become as close as family to me in many cases. I saw parallels with what Kathleen did for her brother and what siblings have to do when they have a missing brother or sister. "My brother is missing. Can you help me?" It's a question I get on average every week. Just as often, the word brother is replaced with sister. Sometimes my help is only needed for a very short time, and I rejoice when those people are found the same day. But sometimes days turn into months, then years, then decades. Brothers and sisters are often in contact with each other daily. I've usually spoken to my sister before 9 a.m. every day. I know what her plans are for the day. I know who she's meeting for lunch. I know what she's planning to make for dinner. Even though I live almost 1,000 kilometres away, I could tell you where she's meant to be and when. If I didn't know that, and her husband didn't know, and our parents didn't know, then I would start to panic fairly quickly. When someone is missing, a brother or sister often knows something has happened. My sister would not go a day without being in contact with me. When people do something out of character, a phrase I hear and use on a daily basis, then you just know something is wrong. When your sister fails to pick up her kids from school, when your brother doesn't turn up for footy training, when your sister decides to get in the car and drive interstate on a whim, when your brother is meant to come over for dinner but doesn't show. Those are the times when brothers and sisters start to worry, and that worry quickly turns into panic. So what do they do when that happens? At what point do they get the police involved? They think about calling the police, only to find their sister's car broke down and her mobile battery went flat, and she's fine after all. And she's cranky that you embarrassed her by calling the police. But what if she's not fine? What if something actually did happen? Brothers and sisters of missing people lived with guilt daily. Did I do enough? Should I have gone out looking that night? I should have answered the call instead of letting it go to voicemail. Why didn't I spot the signs that he was depressed before he went missing? Why didn't I take her seriously when she mentioned suicide? And then, like Kathleen, you have to tell people someone is missing. You have to tell their boss, their friends, their co-workers. At what point do you make those calls when someone is missing? After they've been missing a day, a week? When do you feel you have to start letting people know something has happened to that brother or sister? Do you keep paying your sister's rent? For how long? What about her car payments? Those practical jobs often fall to brothers and sisters. The moment a brother or sister goes missing, lives are instantly changed. The people you will meet in these chapters are not the same people as they were the day before their sibling was last seen. I remember reading about one father of a missing girl. He was getting a haircut and he saw the hairdressers whispering together and looking his way, sympathetic, but not knowing how to talk to him. He left in tears. Wherever you go, whatever you do, when you have a missing person in your world, people start to see you as something or someone different to how you were before. They define you by what has happened to the missing one. You are now the missing girl's father, the missing girl's brother. You are not just you anymore. The stories in this book are all different, but they have common threads that seem to link them all. You'll see lots of similar patterns in each chapter. All of them have vivid dreams of their missing siblings, and sometimes they feel like the missing ones are trying to give them a message. Most of them still look for their siblings in crowds. There is a great deal of survivor guilt with many of them. Did they do enough to try and find the missing one? Have they done enough in the years since to keep their missing siblings in the public eye and convince people to keep looking for them? Almost all of them have consulted psychics and mediums at some stage, and every single one of them cried when I spoke to them. I hope this book will help these families to talk about what they've been through, and I hope it will give the community a glimpse into their worlds. I hope that if you have a missing person, this might give you some comfort in knowing you are not alone, and that others have been through exactly what you have. And I really, really hope that you, as the reader, will keep looking for the missing and learn about who they were as people before it all changed, before they became a face on a missing person poster. So, to all the sisters and brothers who have had to make that same difficult phone call to people to say something awful has happened, this is for you. These are your stories. Chapter 1, Kay Docherty and Toni Cavanagh. Picture this. Two Aussie teenage girls at the end of the 1970s, going to school, going to discos on Friday nights and weekends, hanging out with their friends, hitchhiking to the beaches. No longer kids, but not yet adults. In 1979, Kathy Lett and Gabrielle Carey wrote Puberty Blues, the classic but controversial novel about teenage girls set in the Sutherland Shire, just an hour away from where Kay Docherty and Toni Cavanagh lived, in Warilla in the Illawarra region of New South Wales. It was also the year Kay and Toni vanished, never to be seen or heard from again. Warilla at that time was a growing coastal community made up of lots of young families, so there were always other kids in the local streets to play with. Tracy Shelton was one of those kids, went to the same school as Kay and Toni, and was close friends with Tony's older sister, Vicky. "We all lived in housing commission houses," says Tracy. Back then, there was no stigma attached to housing commission. All the dads worked at the steelworks, a lot of the mothers stayed at home. "We were all from middle-class families. We never went without. There was always meat and three veg. We always had a packed lunch and clean clothes. The houses were always spotlessly clean. Just normal families. We didn't know the Dochertys well, but you could tell they were a decent family." Kevin and Kay Docherty were twins, born 5 minutes apart in Wollongong Hospital. "Kay was the first one out," Kevin tells me with a laugh. In 1965, the family moved to Warilla. Kay was a very happy-go-lucky kid. "When I think of her," Kevin starts to recall his sister as a child, but the emotion sweeps over him and he struggles to get the words out. "There was always a smile and we had a great childhood. She was always more of a follower than a leader. She was quiet and did well at school, better than me," Kevin says with a grin. The kids they were friends with as children remained their friends as teenagers. All the kids would play out in the streets until it got dark. "Kay was scared of the dark," says Kevin. "Mum was really protective of us. We were allowed to play in the street just as long as she knew where we were, as long as she could see us, as long as she knew the other kids. Mostly we played near our house. Mum didn't like taking her eye off us." Both Kevin and Kay attended Lake Illawarra High School in the same year as Toni Cavanagh. Mavia Cavanagh is Toni's stepmother, and she raised Toni and her sister Vicky from when they were very young. "I married Toni's father when Toni was 5 and Vicky was 6, says Mavia. They'd been shuffled from pillar to post. They lived with lots of different people before we got married. It was really difficult. I was terribly young myself. I took the children on when I was only 20. Toni had a lot going on in her life. It would have been hard for her. There was a lot of unhappiness in the house. She and I got on really well, but she was insecure. She had it hard from the start in the first 4 years of her life. I never had problems with Toni. She was never nasty to me, never said I wasn't her real mother or anything like that." Tracy, who was best friends with Toni's older sister Vicky, remembers Mavia and Toni being very close. "Anyone walking into that house would not know Mavia was her stepmother and not her real mother." Toni was clearly deeply loved by her family, who find it extremely painful to talk about her. "Toni was a bubbly sort of person," says Tracy. "She was very softly spoken, but she was always cracking up laughing. She was very happy." Most people love their mums, but Kevin Docherty's devotion to his mum Jean is remarkable and beautiful. Part of that devotion is because when Kay went missing, Kevin was really all his mum had left. "Mum and I were close. We were really, really close," says Kevin. "We became closer after my sister went missing. When I was 15 and 9 months, I made a pact with my mum that I would never leave her. At that age, I probably didn't know what I was saying, but I'm a man of my word and I honoured that. It's something I had to do. She was a beautiful person, and she didn't deserve all the hardship she had in her life. She tried to do everything right. Everything was about her family. I needed her as much as she needed me. As I got older, I realised that more. I'm proud to have been in the position that I was, being able to look after her. I left everything. My job, I was about to get married and have kids and buy a house, but I left all of that to be with my mum. I spoke with another school friend of both Kay and Toni, who has asked to remain anonymous. She's eager to give me her perspective on the girls. Kay had a different personality to Toni. They weren't close friends, but there were groups at the school of girls who were best friends, and those circle of girls always overlapped. They always had groups of girls who would mingle together. You'd quite often see large groups of girls together doing things, but Toni and Kay were in separate groups of friends. I'd known Toni longer than I'd known Kay. I went to kindy with Toni, then right the way through, and I met Kay in high school. I met her on the first day of grade 7 and instantly liked her. She was just the sort of person that you couldn't not like. She was kind, generous and open. She was quietly confident. She was a good student. She worked hard for her good grades, and that was important to her. She was good at sports too. One of those kids who was good at everything. She was very popular, really well liked, because she had such a lovely personality. Both the twins were very well liked. Kay and Toni were similar in a lot of ways, but had very different personality types. They were both quiet girls. Kay knew what she wanted to do in life. She had a smaller group of friends that she would confide in, and the rest of the girls she'd always be pleasant to. Toni was very small, a very tiny girl. She was only 5'2" at best. She was thin and had strawberry blonde hair. I think she was the target of bullies at times. She lacked some self-confidence. I can remember an incident at one of the school dances where she had been bullied and one of the girls actually punched her. I remember walking over and asking what was going on. Toni really didn't have the confidence to stand up to her. However, Tracy disagrees with the idea that Toni was bullied and thinks she could hold her own if necessary. Maybe that was a one-off occasion. She didn't pick fights, that's for sure, but if she and Vicky had a fight, it was on. Toni wouldn't back down. They had sisterly name-calling, pushing and shoving, slamming doors like every other normal family. But at school, I never remember anyone ever picking on her. Mavia also doesn't think Toni was bullied at school and remembers her having a lot of friends. She always had people in tow and was bringing them home. It's important to Mavia and her family that people understand Toni was not the wild child she may have been portrayed as in the media, and they're upset that Toni is seen as the instigator of what happened that night. Mavia believes the girls planned the evening together and says it's not fair that people seem to think it's all Tony's fault. She says that Toni was no angel, but she was far from being bad. I'd say she did get up to mischief at times, but no one ever told me she did anything terribly bad. She wasn't totally innocent, but she was a kind and loving girl. She was very social. She was at that giggly, girly stage that all teenagers get to. These days, they'd all be on their phones together. You just can't put all the blame on one of them, especially at that age. Kay had a small circle of close friends, and being the same age, she and Kevin often shared friends. When we went to high school, we started to get different friends.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.